Okay, so in the last class, we had started with the male reproductive system and we had just overlooked at what the testis is in terms of its physical characteristics and the location. Now, looking at the overall male reproductive system, again, most of the structures you are very well aware of. But then few of them, they might be newly added to your maybe knowledge or vocabulary. So, and this is the lateral view of the male reproductive system. So what you see on the top is actually your urinary bladder. Just below that, you will see a prostate gland. And actually below the prostate gland, there is a Cowper's gland, which is not shown in this diagram. But it is located here itself at the base of the penis. Yeah. Then there is pubic bone. Can someone tell me what is this pubic bone here? What do you think? Where is it coming from? Akshay?
Oh, the pelvic girdle.
Correct. So the junction of the pelvic girdle, that is the pubis, or also called as pubic bone. So that bone is what you see here, because your urinary bladder is kind of resting onto that pelvic girdle structure. And so the front or the bottommost part that is connecting between the two left and right of the pelvic girdle, that is the pubis bone. So that is what is being seen here. Then vas deferens, we will see individually this structures in detail. So vas deferens is the tube that extends from this what we call the seminal vesicle structure, and which is ultimately connecting to the internal tube, which is called as urethra in the penis structure. That is deferens, urethra, and then of course the erectile tissues which are present in the penis. The testis is shown, epididymis is shown, the scrotum, that is the pouch-like structure, then yeah, the rectum and the anus part is not really shown here, but yeah, of course, the opening will be called as the anus. So this is the general male reproductive system in terms of lateral view. The same structures are being shown here, just in terms of simplistic representation from the front view. Yeah, so that is what you see here, and like I said, this is the bladder. Just below the bladder you will have your prostate gland, and below the prostate gland at the base you will have the Cowper's gland, which is another type of gland involved in the secretions of the male reproductive system. These are the seminal vesicles, and we will see a type of canal through which this vas deferens enters, that is inguinal canal. I will show you that later. But yeah, so this is the front view of the male reproductive system. Now, going further into back into the testis, with respect to the what are the different layers or what are the different microscopic structures present in the testis. So it majorly consists of three protective coverings. They are called as tunicae. Yeah, and each of these testis is surrounded by these three layers or three tunicae. You can label them as tunica vaginalis, tunica albuginea, and tunica vasculosa. Now, this vaginalis is actually coming from the fact that in case of females, it's the same type of developmental cell during embryonic development. They originate from the similar structure. So there is something in female which is like from where the vagina is originated. And in this case of the testis, these are the same developmental cells which differentiate differently into males and females. So that's why the name is similar to vagina. from the female. So that is tunica vaginalis, that's the outermost layer. Tunica albuginea, that is the middle one layer, and this is more like a fibrous in nature, so that it can hold the complete structure in like a very well, that scrotal sac. It can hold the whole of the inner contents of the testis in the testis sac, not the scrotal sac. Tunica vasculosa, and the name again itself says vasculosa refers to vasculature, that is the capillaries and so on. It is supported by the very thin and actually a delicate connective tissue which lines the tunica albuginea. So sometimes we may not be able to differentiate between albuginea and vasculosa, but because we can see the capillaries, that's the only way we differentiate the vasculosa. So these are the three layers, and again to show you in the diagram, so this is the section of the testis, and what you see here is the outermost layer, that is tunica vaginalis, then tunica albuginea, that is the kind of off-white layer that you see in second, and inside this albuginea is your capillary network, and that is called as tunica vasculosa. So these are the three protective coverings on the testis structure. Now innermost structure of the testis, that is testicular lobules. Now lobules refers to kind of compartments. So each of these testis, it consists of approximately 250 compartments. Some textbooks, they might say 200 to 300 and so on, but approximately 250 we can say, called as testicular lobules. Individually they are called as testicular lobules. Each of these contains a highly coiled 1 to 3 in number seminiferous tubules. So each of these lobules or testicular lobules will have 1 to 3 seminiferous tubules, and these are just the coiled structures. So the seminiferous tubules, it is lined with a single layer of germinal epithelium. Germinal epithelium, it is called germinal because it will give rise to the germ cell. Germ cells is your gamete cells. And epithelium is the innermost opening of those tubules, right? So when you look at the tube, whatever is the layer on the inside of that tube, that is called as epithelium in human body. So it is the germinal epithelium lined seminiferous tubules, and these germinal epithelium cells, they are cuboidal. Cuboidal is the shape, I'm sure you know this. And spermatogenic cells. Spermatogenic they are called because they give rise to the sperm. The like prior cells before the sperms, from where the sperms are getting formed. So that is the germinal epithelial cells, and they are also called as the spermatogenic cells. With few large pyramidal shaped cells, and these pyramidal cells, they are called as Sertoli cells. So in short, what we have seen as of now, inside the seminiferous tubules, you will have two types of cell. The inner lining is the germinal epithelium, and in between these germinal epithelium, what you will see is some pyramidal shaped cell, that is Sertoli cells. The male germ cells, they are called as spermatocytes. Again, this is the earlier version of spermatozoa, which is yet to completely mature, and so that's why they are called as spermatocytes. They undergo meiotic division and lead to the sperm formation. And now if you remember the mitosis and meiosis process, it is always said that meiosis happens in the germ cells to give rise to the gametes. So that is what it means. From these epithelial cells of the seminiferous tubules, they will undergo meiosis process. Again, there are several divisions which we will see in the formation of the sperm, but several divisions happen, and at the end meiosis happens, which will lead to the sperm formation. Sertoli cells, they will provide the attachment and nutrition to the developing sperm. The function of this pyramidal Sertoli cell is to provide the nutrition and attachment to the sperm while they are growing or maturing into the complete sperm. So these are the parts of the seminiferous tubule. Now, if I show, I have put it at wrong place, but I hope you can see this. I will keep this somewhere here. So if you look at this diagram in the transverse section, so the reason I have kept this diagram is so that you can visualize this. So this is one testis. When you take a section of it, what you see is this type of seminiferous tubules, and individual seminiferous tubule will have, this is the outer lining of this round part that is being shown. So this is one seminiferous tubule, and if you have to look at that, how does it look like? So this is one testis. Again, it is cut vertically. So these are the individual lobules, and this coiled structure in a like a snake like fashion that is being shown here, that is your seminiferous tubule. Again, here if you look at this tunica vaginalis and tunica albuginea, these are the layers which are being shown here. And the inner compartment is divided into the lobules, right? Or what is called as testicular lobules. So these seminiferous tubules, when they are sectioned, what you get is your Sertoli cells. Like these are the pyramidal cells, and this is the round part is one seminiferous tubule. Inside that there is Sertoli cell, and the inner core of this seminiferous tubule is lined with the germinal epithelium. Now, this diagram may not show you the germinal epithelium because the obviously the cells have been differentiated into spermatocytes. Like from the edge towards the center, they undergo the differentiation process, and at the center, what you have is actually the mature sperm. We will have a look at this. This diagram I have kept here so that simplistically how you can draw these structures. That is why I have kept, because this also look very complicated, but because it provides all the levels, that's why it is there. So when you have to draw the structure, you can draw it in this simplistic fashion along with these interstitial cells which are being shown. Where is it? Yeah, these in between the seminiferous tubule, what you have is the interstitial cells. So that we will see now. So I hope this part is clear with respect to seminiferous tubules, what it contains and so on. Then the next part within the testis, the microscopic structure, that is the Leydig cells. These are present in the connective tissue between the adjacent seminiferous tubule, like I had shown in the diagram here. Between the adjacent seminiferous tubule, in the space in between, what you have is the Leydig cells, or they are also called as interstitial cells. And they are a group of large polygonal cells because they have many sides, so they are polygonal in shape. These cells will synthesize and secrete the testicular male hormone called as androgens. Androgens, like later than you would know it as testosterone, as an example. So these interstitial cells and Leydig cells, these are the most important part of the testis. And of course, others are also important, but because they secrete the hormone, they become one of the most important structure in the testis. So this is what your testis would contain in terms of the section. Yeah. That is the germinal epithelium, or which is also called here, like if you look at this, I don't know where is it shown, I can't see. Here it is shown. Germinal epithelium, that is the outermost lining. If you see this, then the next layer is primary spermatocyte, then secondary spermatocyte, then spermatids. And again, like I said, we will see this differentiation in the sperm formation process. But in the diagram, layer wise, they have been given, starting from the germinal epithelium to the primary, then secondary, then spermatids, and finally the sperm, spermatozoa, or sperm, you can simply call them so. And these are the Sertoli cells, which are shown in the triangular or pyramidal shape, and the interstitial cells or Leydig cells. So just a simpler representation of the section of the testis as it is. So I hope this part is clear. Now continuing with the rest of the structures which are associated with testis and not within the testis. Okay. That is reti, or it is majorly called as reti testis, and the vas efferens. Again, the plural is vasa efferentia. This is the singular. So reti testis and vas efferens. The seminiferous tubules, they are closed at one end, and they can join at the other from the network, which is called as reti testis. What it means is, they are closed at one end because they are connected in a like this is like a pipe like continuation, and this network of the tubules which is opening to the seminiferous tubules, that is called as reti testis. So that is what it means. From where 15 to 20 fine ciliated ductules. Ductules is again a small tubes, that's why they are called as ductules. So 15 to 20 of them, they will emerge into the vasa efferentia structure, and that is what will arise from the reti testis. So if I go back to that diagram, where is the vasa efferentia labeled here? No, it's not labeled, but this is different. I must mention it here. This is vasa differentia or vas deferens. These efferent ductules, they are entering into the epidermis structure. So these are the ones which are called as vasa efferentia. Yeah, these ductules that you see here, which are so seminiferous tubules continuing with reti testis, continuing with this vasa efferentia entering into the epididymis. So that is the vasa efferentia and the reti testis structure. Now at places, these vasa efferentia bear the cilia to aid the sperm transport. The presence of cilia is majorly like claiming to the fact that the sperm has to get transported over the tubule structure, and that's why they are ciliated in nature. That is the another structure associated with testis. The next structure that we are going to see is the epididymis, that is also called as epididymides. Yeah, again the plural and the singular one. It is a comma shaped organ. Now it's not literally like of the size of comma, but the just the shape is like a comma, formed of 6 meter highly convoluted tube. Now 6 meter, you can imagine it's pretty long otherwise, but because it is located just above the testis, it is so much convoluted, and that is why it can fit into that much of size, lying along the upper, lower and inner side of the testis. It is very stratified epithelium. So if you look, upper, middle and the lower part of the testis, and that is where the whole of the epididymis is lined along, and they are lined with the pseudo stratified. Stratified in general means layer of cell, and pseudo stratified means like kind of false layers. They are not the actual layers because their nucleus is located on the top side of the cells, and that is why they are called so pseudo stratified. The epididymis in general is divided into 3 parts, that is the head, body and the tail part. Head is also called as caput epididymis, which will receive the sperms from the reti testis and from the vasa efferentia and then it will continue with the body of the epididymis, which is called as corpus epididymis, and this is the middle narrower part, and the tail is called as cauda epididymis. So if I have to show you, this upper part is what is known as caput epididymis. The middle part is the corpus epididymis, and this tail part that you see is known as cauda epididymis. So these are the three different parts of the epididymis. Functionally, they have no other function than to take away the secretion from the testis to the vas deferens or vasa differentia. So that is their main function, being a tubular structure. Then specifically in case of this caput epididymis, that is the head part of the epididymis, the semen is concentrated and by the reabsorption tubule. Reabsorption tubule as in, let's say if the male individual does not ejaculate for long amount of time, then those sperms which are already present in the seminal vesicles, they are being reabsorbed and stored into the caput epididymis, that is the upper part or the head part of the epididymis. And that is where, otherwise, when the sperms are being produced in the testis and then they are being carried, that is where the sperms will mature and become motile and physiologically active to fertilize the egg. So their maturation and complete physiological differentiation happens in this caput epididymis, that is the head part. From this head part, the sperm will pass down to the cauda epididymis, and that's where they are stored for a while before entering the vas deferens. So before they enter into this tube-like structure that is on the top being shown, they will be stored into this cauda epididymis, that is the tail portion of the epididymis. Now in this diagram, what you also see that this tube looks like it is emerging from either behind or from the center, but this tube is kind of going over the testis, and that is being that is not really visualized here. I'm not sure if I can show you that somewhere. I don't think I have that. Here maybe you can see it. Yeah, actually this is the epididymis top, body and the tail part, and then you, what you have is the vas deferens structure going like this over the testis, and then that is entering to the inguinal canal. So that is the different parts of this epididymis structure. Again, with respect to function, it will serve as a duct for passage for the sperm from testis to the vas deferens or vasa differentia structure. It will store the sperm prior to ejaculation, and the storage in epididymis makes the sperms motile, because that's what happens in the caput epididymis, that is the head part. That is where they become physiologically completely matured and also motile. Sperm mature during their passage through the epididymis. So these are the various functions of the epididymis structure. Any question here? I hope you have understood what structure is present where and what is the function. Okay, so then moving forward, where is it? Yeah, there is something called as blood testis barrier. So these were most of the structure that they are within and around the testis. So the next thing that comes in the natural course of this description is the blood testis barrier. Now the name itself suggests quite a lot. Like we have blood brain barrier, like between the blood and the brain, whatever fluid goes enters into the brain, there is a special barrier which is called as blood-brain barrier. Something similar, whenever the blood or the nutrition is about to enter into testis, there is a certain barrier which is called as blood testis barrier. So the Sertoli cells, like those pyramidal cells from the seminiferous tubules, they are highly or rather tightly connected with one another and are placed between the layers of spermatogonia. Spermatogonia is the immature form of the sperm. And when these cells, they are tightly connected with each other, that's why they leave no space for like anything to enter or cross across. And more mature forms of these spermatogenic cells, they are also present in that space. And that is why it becomes a very tightly connected area. And this acts as a barrier between the immature and mature spermatogenic cells. And that is what is known as the blood testis barrier.
Sir?
Yeah?
But in the diagram, didn't they show that the Sertoli cells are separated, like by the, yeah.
So that is what they are saying. These immature spermatogenic cell and this Sertoli cell, they are tightly packed so that nothing comes from inside. Now, if you imagine this as a tube-like structure, this is the center of the tube, then it extends like the further and as well as backward. This is like a tube there. And what you are looking at, just the thin slice of the tube. So whatever it is said, the primary or the immature spermatogenic cells and the Sertoli cells, they form a tight connection with each other.
So the Sertoli cells aren't connected to each other?
No, not necessarily.
So like they mentioned a barrier between the spermatogonia and the mature spermatogenic cells.
Mm-hmm.
So like, where is it? The diagram, aren't they like adjacent to each other?
No, no. What they are saying is Sertoli cells are tightly connected with one another, not necessarily with Sertoli cell itself, but just to the neighboring cell. That is what it means by one another. And they are placed between the layer of the immature spermatogenic cells to the mature spermatogenic cells. What does it mean is, these are the mature immature spermatogenic cell, and these are the mature ones, which are more like a sperm, but they are called as spermatids. So that is the most mature form of the sperm. And now again, if you visualize this in three dimension, these will look like they are placed in between these. I don't know if you are able to visualize that way.
So like, it's like a tube, right? So
correct.
So the outermost spermatogonia.
See, according to the statement, what you will imagine is they will be located somewhere here, like, right? Between this immature to the mature ones.
Yes.
Right? But that is not the case. Yeah, they are located. Now again, that's when I say this two-dimension depiction is always difficult to explain the three-dimensional aspect of the cell. Like if you look at the diagram, what you ideally see is the Sertoli cells, they are pointing inward towards the lumen of the tube, right?
Yes.
Again, that is just the section of the Sertoli cell. If you can imagine, how can I explain this to you now? I don't know. I guess I will need to have a three-dimensional representation, then only I can explain.
If you imagine this in 3D, it will be like, if you imagine it as a cross section of a tube, the Sertoli cells will still be pointing inward, right?
Correct. I mean,
aren't they connected? The spermatogonia and the mature, they are like adjacent, right?
Yes. So let me see if I can explain you here somewhere. No, I don't see that as well. This is still. Yeah, not really. Okay, I guess I will have to draw the diagram for that. And then, or I will find a diagram for this. Because surely it can become like confusing if we look at this diagram and the description we try to match. Okay, so I guess I will come back to this particular part. In just the structural arrangement, it's not that difficult as well. But I will come back to it. I will not say anything else about it. But just like understand that they are actually present between these mature and immature spermatogenic cell as of now. And then we will come back to this fact in the maybe next class or at the end of this class. So even the arterial blood, that is the blood that supplies to the testis, cannot reach the more mature spermatogenic cells. More mature because they are present at the center. And not even blood can reach the most mature sperm. Again, the reason why this happens, or you might wonder then how does the sperms get the nutrition? So the actual reason why they don't allow the blood to pass is because like the actual the sperms, or the mature, most mature sperms, which are present at the inside, they do not want to get in contact with the immune cells of the body, right? Because immune cells has the ability to kill the cells. Now, sometimes due to some inflammatory processes, the sperms might get killed through the course of action of the regular check by the immune cell. And to avoid that process, this blood testis barrier is very, very important, though the cells are our own cells. So if at all this blood testis barrier gets broken, the immune system will start a response towards the unfamiliar spermatogenic cell. Unfamiliar as in the broken ones or worn out ones and so on, and will destroy them. And sometime it will cause the sterility, because the ultimately the sperm count will be less, and the it can lead to the cause of the sterility, because slowly it will start killing the spermatogenic cells. And once the spermatogenic cells are dead, it cannot give rise to the sperm, because that's where the sperms would come from. So that is the idea behind the blood testis barrier.
Sir.
Yes.
So like the spermatogenic cells, these are the more mature forms, right?
Immature.
But spermatogonic is the immature, right? Or
so spermatogonium is the single singular term. Where is that diagram? So if you see this, spermatogonium is this.
Yes.
Right? And this is what is called as primary spermatogenic cell, or then later which differentiates into the primary spermatocyte and so on.
So
continue.
So the blood, the immune system doesn't recognize these cells.
Immune system cannot pass inside.
So like if it passes inside, so like what does it mean by unfamiliar spermatogenic cells? So some are familiar, some are unfamiliar.
So unfamiliar is not the right terminology there, but unfamiliar means that these cells, the spermatogenic cells, they have not been exposed to the immune system yet. That does not mean they don't exist or so, but like each and every cell of the body has a specific antigen which is recognized by the immune cell. And when these cells, they come in contact with the immune cells, they will recognize it as a self cell, and they will just let that cell grow on its own. As and when these cells recognize, oh, this cell I'm not aware of, and that antigen is foreign, the immune cell will start killing the whatever cell that is. Then whether it is a our own body cell or whether it is outside cell, because that immune cell has not come across this spermatogenic cells earlier, so that they are not aware of their antigens. Did you get what I said?
Yeah, I got it. But isn't that kind of like useless? Like, rather than doing all this, can't the like immune cells not attack? Like,
see, immune cells, they are trained like military of the body. They will kill if they find anything which they cannot recognize.
So is it like because like spermatogenic cells are going under constant mutations that they can't recognize? Or
see the reason I said is because the blood cannot enter the testis, this blood testis barrier. So like during the earlier stages of the development, all the cells of the body, they have been exposed to the immune cell. So the immune cell recognizes them as a familiar one. Spermatogenic cells, because blood cannot enter this testis structure, so obviously the immune cells, they have no exposure to whatever cells are present inside, and that is why they don't recognize them. The moment the blood will start entering, or if this blood testis barrier is broken, they will recognize these as foreign cells and they will start killing. Is it still confusing?
No, I mean, I got it, but I mean, I got what happens, but I thought it's redundant.
No, so not all the cells within the body, they should be recognized by the immune cell, and this is one of those types.
Spermatogenic cells not being recognized serves a purpose.
That is done to adapt a certain function. Because you imagine, no, let's say a certain spermatogenic cell is it's kind of let's say different than the other spermatogenic cell. Different in the sense, now again, different I mean by the expression of the proteins, because it is surrounded by the Sertoli cell, or there is some physiological stress, or there is some metabolic stress. Any of these situations, they can change the expression of the proteins within a particular cell. Now, the moment that happens, the expression pattern of the antigens on the surface changes, because those cells, when they are in stress, they have to give the signal to the neighboring cells and so on, so that they survive. So in that process, they will be recognized as foreign cells and the immune cells will kill them. So you will keep on losing the spermatogenic cells, and their primary function is not to tackle the stress, but rather to generate the sperms. The moment the sperm generation does not happen, it will ultimately lead into the sterility. So that is the sequence of events.
Okay, so like there is no immune system, there is like no immune response inside the blood testis barrier. So if a germ gets there, then it can grow very fast.
Germs can also not go there, because then in that case, the cells have its own defense system in terms of different enzymes and proteins, which will kind of break open these whatever microbes or so. See, the only way germs can enter the testis structure is through a physical cut on the testis. Otherwise, how will they enter?
Yeah.
Because the blood itself is not going, so nothing from the blood will be able to. Okay. So I hope that part is clear. And so that was just a quick idea about what the blood testis barrier is, and how the testis, or how the sperms, they are being protected from everything else So it's like a whole system in itself, which does not trust or which does not allow any other system to take care of them. So that is the testis structure having the blood testis bag. Then moving to the next part in the male reproductive system after the testis, that is the vas deferens or ductus deferens, or in plural it is called as vasa differentia. Again, these are all the same name for the same structure. It is kind of 40 centimeter long tube arising from the tail part of the epididymis, which is cauda epididymis, and ascends, that is comes upward into the abdominal cavity through this inguinal canal. Now I told you about this. We need to look at, have a look, because structurally to understand where exactly this is, it is very, very important. Now, I had also mentioned during the developmental stages, the testis descends into the scrotal sac from the inguinal canal, right? So now this is the pubic area, that whatever you are seeing, this is the penis. This is the other testis, and this is one testis which is kind of opened with in terms of the skin layers. Yeah. So this canal that you see from where this blood arteries and veins are coming, that is called as inguinal canal. Yeah, here it is superficial inguinal ring that you see, and it is like a there are different segments of this inguinal canal, like lower inguinal canal and superior superficial inguinal canal and so on. We need not go into that details, but inguinal canal is a tube-like structure which allows the arteries, veins and the vas deferens structure to come out from the testis and then join at the bottom of the urethra or the penile structure. So that is, and it is present on the both sides, like it is shown on this side, exactly same will be present on the other side as well. So there are two inguinal canals present at the central axis, around the central axis of the body, just below the, the side of the urinary bladder. So it's kind of triangular, like in terms, they start from the sides of the body and they kind of merge as in not completely, but the direction is towards the penis or the scrotal or the testis structure. So these vas deferens, they ascend into the abdominal cavity, that is from testis they go up through the inguinal canal, loops over the urinary bladder, like around the urinary bladder, and joins the duct of the seminal vesicle to form the ejaculatory duct. Now let me show you this part. Oh, where is that diagram? Yeah, here I can show you that. So from the testis, this vas deferens structure is going around, it kind of loops around the bladder structure and then joins this seminal vesicle, which is shown like a small bag or pouch like structure, and joins this ejaculatory duct in continuation with the main duct of the penis, yeah, or the urethra, you can say. So that is what is the vas deferens structure. Where am I? Yeah. The end of the vas deferens dilates to form a spindle-like ampulla. Ampulla is just a little pouch or a sac-like structure for a temporary storage of the sperm. Like when you blow a balloon, at the end and at where you blow from, they are kind of constricted, and in between you have a big bulge-like structure. So that is something like ampulla. So that that is present at the end of the vas deferens, so that it acts as the temporary storage of the sperm. So you can imagine there is a temporary storage at the tail of the epididymis. Then at the end of vas deferens, there is another storage area. Again, these are all temporary storage area for the sperm. lined with pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium. Columnar, column-shaped, pseudo-stratified because they are false layer-like structure of the epithelial cells. And the muscular walls are made of the smooth muscles. So different layers, the epithelium will be the innermost layer. Below the epithelium, on the outer side, will be the muscular walls. And then there will be one more covering to cover it, cover the whole of the vas deferens structure. So these different layers, they will form this tube or the ductus deferens. Now the peristaltic movement or the contraction of the smooth muscles help in the propulsion of the sperm through the vas deferens structure. So the movement of the sperm does not happen on its own. It needs some contractions or some peristaltic movement from the smooth muscles of that vas deferens. And that's how the sperm keep moving from the testis or from the epididymis to the towards the seminal vesicle and ultimately in the urethra. The free end of its cells also bear the stereo cilia. Now stereo cilia is something like we all know of microvilli structure in the intestine. Something similar exists in the towards the free end of the vas deferens cell. Free end as in again towards the opening kind of structure. And they will have this stereo cilia, which is like a microvilli like structure, so that there is quite a lot of surface area. And plus the movement of that vas deferens structure for movement of the sperm, that is that will happen. The vas deferens ascends the pelvic cavity through the inguinal canal along with the testicular artery, testicular vein, and the nerves that supply the testes. So that is what I shown you in the diagram. All of the structure, vein, arteries, nerve, and the vas deferens, they all go through or ascend into the abdominal, into the from the pelvic cavity to the abdominal cavity with this inguinal canal, which together is called as spermatic cord. So all these testicular artery, testicular vein, nerves, and the vas deferens is together called as the spermatic cord, which enters through the inguinal canal. So that is the vas deferens structure. Any doubt here so far?
The ampulla is just before the vas deferens joins the seminal vesicle duct.
I don't know if now here actually it is not shown. Here also it is not shown. So before actually it meets this seminal vesicle structure, no, this tube is little in little more in terms of diameter. That's what is the ampulla structure, and then it ultimately enters into the seminal vesicle part, which is again like an ampulla structure because it has higher diameter than the vas deferens. So that's what it means.
So vas deferens enters, it doesn't enter, right? The seminal vesicle?
It continues with the seminal vesicle. You can say that way. It doesn't enter like a tube enters something else. It is actually the continuation structure of the tube.
So, but it's different in the diagram, right? I mean, here the... It's going through one end and coming through another.
So this part is your vas deferens, correct?
Yes.
Now forget about the ampulla. The moment it stop here, it is continuing in the same tubular format, just the different diameter and different convoluted part as the seminal vesicle. It's like how you have small intestine and large intestine, something of same nature.
So, but in the other diagram, sir, it's
again the diagrams, they are not the actual structures always, right? Diagrams are just representations of what exactly exists. So do not get confused by those at all. If I want to draw, I might just draw this whole round structure here around the vas deferens, and then I will continue like into the prostate gland and so on. So these diagrams, because they are done by different people for whatever purpose, they will always have some or the other confusing parameter. So don't go by those diagrams. Just try and understand the structure. And when you have to draw, you can draw something like this, which is simpler.
So in the end, does the vas deferens go through the seminal vesicle or does it not? Like both of them are diagrams, right? So which is correct?
No, it doesn't go through. It continues into the seminal vesicle, which is like this. And this is the correct way, representation.
So it enters the seminal vesicle through one side and leaves it through another?
No, why it has to leave? It continues. So the walls of the vas deferens, they will continue as the walls of the seminal vesicle.
Yeah, like that I understood. But the structure inside the seminal vesicle, like some cells, specialized cells and all, for releasing semen and all, will be different than the vas deferens, right?
Yeah, correct.
So like it's kind of like an organ then, the seminal vesicle.
Yeah, that's a separate structure altogether.
Okay, fine.
I don't know where the confusion is exactly.
No, like, so these two diagrams are there. So like before when we studied, Akka told us that it doesn't like join with the seminal vesicle. It just like the seminal vesicle, a duct is coming out and that duct joins the vas deferens and both of them combine and go on.
Actually, seminal vesicle is not another structure like it is shown in this. Where is that diagram? Yeah, here. It's not completely like how it is shown here. Usually, what we have, I will try to find the three actual image of the this whole reproductive system, actualizing the internal image of the organs. Then you will have a clear idea of how exactly they look like. Because like I said, these are representation. If you know from the tubular structures of the body, like how we have small intestine and large intestine, they are ultimately in continuation with each other. And there is as such like no difference in terms of tube, but the structural formation of those tubes in terms of cell is drastically different because one does something else and the other structure does something else. These two are also something on the same note. Okay.
Okay.
It's 2:30 already, no? What is next? Where is it? Yeah, I guess we can stop here because in the next class, then we can start with this remaining part of the reproductive.